I'm going to be showing examples from, that are published by many different groups, many different organizations. So I want to be clear at the outset that although I've pulled together this compilation for us all to discuss today, a lot of the work that we'll see, a lot of the results that we'll see are coming from other researchers at other organizations, as well as some work from GSAP here at Stanford. Energy systems analysis is a very flexible term. You can imagine a lot of things falling under that umbrella. So I wanted to just whet our appetites by mentioning some concrete things that we're going to come across during our talk. So one question, one somebody might be interested in, would be which produces more emissions, combustion of traditional biomass, agriculture, forestry, or fossil fuels, right? We're all thinking about climate, which of those is bigger, is more important. Each of them has challenges if you're thinking that are unique to that class, thinking about mitigation. What about the energy spend that we need to make in order to get useful energy to run our economy? And which technologies have which characteristics within that question, right? So coal-fired versus photovoltaic energy. What's the energy spend for one versus the other? And how should that inform our thinking about choosing between these two or many other possibilities? This is the first year now that, that fuel cell vehicles are available. Passenger fuel cell vehicles are available for purchase to consumers. Pretty exciting from a technology standpoint. Is it a win for the environment? I'd certainly like to think so. But it's one vehicle is part of a very complex technological ecosystem. How should we think about that question? How can we approach that? So with that, with those things to look forward to, let me now dive into more systematically. So there are many flavors of energy systems analysis. We're not going to talk about ice cream, but this is here to illustrate there are many flavors of energy systems analysis. And so I'm going to start by offering a taxonomy which of energy systems analysis, which aligns well with our work at GSAP, just to, at the starting point. So one type of energy systems analysis is compiling information about energy infrastructure, is stocks and flows of energy, right? From the 50,000 foot view, where is the energy coming from? Where is it going? Where is it converting between one form and another? How, you know, where the energy service sectors fit into the larger economy to provide energy to buildings, to provide energy to transportation. Now, there's a different kind of question, which is, in a sense, more granular than the first. And I want to think about two different technologies or a range of different technological options, such as for generating electricity. How do I think about the costs and benefits associated with different options providing the same energy service? What are the trade-offs involved? Maybe one is more efficient, but the other has more toxic effluents in its manufacture, all kinds of questions like this. And this gets to some very practical on-the-ground policy questions when somebody is thinking about what kind of biofuel incentives to establish, or self-generation incentives to establish, right? What should we favor? What are we valuing? And then getting even more down to the ground level, looking at one specific technology. I'm previously a research chemist, and I was doing some electric catalysis research, and you probably just came from Jens Norstedt's talk and others. How should I think about, as a catalysis researcher, the relationship between a technical improvement I might make in my catalyst and the potential for impact in the larger energy system, right? What's the connection between specific technological advances and the dynamics of our larger energy system with respect to climate or energy availability? So I will show some examples for all of these three characteristics, right? Starting from high level to low level. I see a hand, and I should have mentioned at the outset, let me mention a couple of things. First of all, the slides that I'm showing you today, once I toss them off a little bit, will be online and available to anybody. Second thing is I'm going to ask, if it's okay with everybody, to hold your questions to the end. I look forward to them, and there is time dedicated at the end. I have about 60 slides, and if we're pushing the hour, I will skip to make sure that we have time for questions. So one other thing we should mention by way of introduction is who does energy systems analysis? What is this nebulous thing which happens out there in the somewhere? For you, some of you may be sitting at those somewhere places, I already know this, but it's worth remark, and this is, by the way, a representative list, not a comprehensive or exhaustive list. It's illustrative. So one sort of organization that does energy systems analysis are national labs here in the United States and other countries as well. Okay, so Berkeley Lab across the bay has quite a substantial program. Argonne Labs has done a lot of work in fuels and manages the GREET model, which gives an analysis for source of biofuels and other things like that. Enbrel is the science in this field. That's a national renewable energy laboratory in Colorado. Academic organizations, such as GSAT at Stanford, the Paul Ferry Institute in Switzerland, Princeton, and many others, have academic research programs that often complement the science and engineering research going on at those same institutions. Non-governmental or semi-governmental organizations, I shouldn't say non-governmental, the U.S. Energy Information Administration, as well as the IEA, which is an OECD organization, put out very substantial volumes of information that contribute to our knowledge base. And finally, large energy companies, especially oil majors, produce, many of them, annual forecasts and statistical compilations that, again, provide just a wealth of data. The challenge, in my experience, is often sorting through it and finding information, useful information in the data. So here are at least four classes of organizations which do some form of energy systems analysis. Taxonomy, this is going to serve as an outline for us. So we'll start by looking at a couple of high-level examples and then, you know, move toward the technology side as we go along. So I'll remark on sort of characteristic toolkits that are involved for each of the scales of energy systems analysis. And these high-level compilations basically rely on statistical data, collecting a lot of data from a lot of places, aligning it, and providing it as a useful format. So this is a chart that many of you may have seen. Livermore Lab, not far from here, has for many years compiled what's called a Sankey diagram that illustrates energy flow. This is specific to the United States. And it tracks I call it energy vectors. What form is energy in when it comes into our economy, and what sector does it go to? And Livermore Labs specifically breaks out the electricity sector in that box at the top. So if we want kind of a snapshot of, and let me just make this explicit here, that the width of each of these paths is proportional to the quantity of energy flowing along that. So this gives us a really visually accessible snapshot of where the energy is coming from in our country, where it's going, how much goes through the electricity sector. One thing that I find interesting is over here on this side, they break out explicitly at the end here, energy services versus rejected energy. What rejected energy means? That means when we have a technology with a less than 100% efficiency, FLR, of course, right? And there's some lost or rejected energy. So it's good to keep in mind, we don't always discuss that there's more rejected energy traveling for our economy than there is energy that goes to provide useful services. One interesting takeaway from this chart. The IEA also has a resource of energy flow diagrams, Sankey diagrams. Now they take a worldwide scope, and so this is a resource by which, I'm not actually going to follow the link just in the interest of time, but I have a couple of snapshots. But I want to share with you that it's a pretty cool dynamic web resource, and it shows very similar plots to what we just saw country by country. Or I think they might have continents. They do have OECD versus non-OECD. They have time resolve data. And so you can actually watch how that Sankey diagram evolves over one or two decades. So here's an example. I know that this text is small. I'm going to try to draw out some highlights just by way of illustration to highlight what is available in this resource. So here's the IEA national level Sankey diagram for India. And so here at the left are the energy inputs, and here at the right are the destination sectors for various forms of energy. So what's going on in India? Well, they import a lot of oil. Wow. They import a lot of oil, much more than they produce domestically. That's interesting. How does that affect the way that they think about how they want their energy sector to evolve? And how does that affect their foreign relations and their research priorities? They produce a lot of coal domestically and import some. They're, as we know, a growing economy. They need to keep energy. What are the health impacts of sourcing so much of their electricity from coal? That probably plays into a lot of the dynamics in India. A lot of bio or waste products. Okay, so a lot of people in India live in the developing world conditions and traditional and agrarian societies. So there's a lot of traditional biomass cookstoves, that sort of thing. Let's see what's happening over on the right side. So industry and transport are smaller than other. I'm going to guess that other is probably domestic home services, although I haven't dug out. But again, things like cooking at home. Let's look at the contrast. So here's the IEA diagram for the U.S. Now, we just saw the little more summary, but this places it on a visually consistent comparison for us. So how does this compare? Well, the U.S. imports approximately equal quantities in energy terms of imported oil and domestically produced oil, and we produce a ton of coal and import very little. We've got a lot of gas production, of course. This has been a big story the last few years. This is not present in a significant way in India's energy resource, so that's a big contrast. One interesting contrast to India is that we put a very large proportion of our energy into transportation, much more than industry. So I leave you with that as one example of the comparison one can draw. This is static in 2014. Again, there's time resolved data and regional sector data as well. Now, GSAP several years ago produced another way of looking at energy flows worldwide, looking at not energy per se, but something called exergy, which some of you may be familiar, and is typically characterized as the useful component of energy. What does that mean? It's thinking about the useful work that can be obtained when a resource is out of equilibrium with its environment and it comes into equilibrium with its environment. The way I think about this, the mental picture in my head is if I have a large boulder right at 5,000 feet, a lot of potential energy there, right? But it's on a plateau, that field's on a plateau at 4,000 feet. So the useful energy I can extract with my environment is what I get when it comes down 1,000 feet, not 5,000 feet at sea level. So what we're really interested in when we're tracking our energy resources is the work that we can get out of it. Of course, we want our energy vectors to be useful things in our economy. So it's a very detailed resource that I know the text is very small, but I want to give you a sense of the information, the granularity of information that's available here, and then some of the high-level insights. So where is the useful energy coming from in our society? So that, as previously, the width of the path is proportional to the magnitude of the resource. So there are basically two types of paths. One is human-appropriated plants, one is agriculture and forestry, and the other, three separate ones for three different fossil pathways. And so we see, if you count up the numbers, you find there's a little bit more energy flowing through our global energy system from fossil resources than there are from forestry and agriculture. So one interesting thing about that is, of course, it's all of our energy resources are ultimately solar resources. It's just that in the case of our fossil resources, they've accumulated over a very long period of time. And we're drawing them down very quickly relative to the quantity of time that it took to accumulate them. So we're getting a lot more energy from dense accumulated energy resources than we are from forestry and agriculture. Those are renewable resources, right? Renewed from year to year. This points toward an extended discussion about peak oil and how we should be thinking about managing our resources with an eye toward the sustainability of our society. And this is a helpful look at the relative magnitude of those. So this is the second half of that diagram, just in the interest of completeness. right? Exergy is ultimately destroyed as we use it to do work. And so where the exergy destroyed on a worldwide basis? A lot of it goes to the vehicle propulsive work, much of it goes to cooking gases, and many others. These charts are already on the GSEP website for anybody who would like to have a look. GSEP also compiled a worldwide carbon flow accounting. So, well, first of all, Livermore Lab does it for the US. So here's the Livermore Lab flow chart. So visually very similar, but it's of course, there's no flux coming from zero carbon energy sources, right? There's no carbon coming from solar, there's no carbon coming from wind. Actually more to say about that, but that's good enough for a first pass. How much of our carbon emissions come from the electricity sector? It turns out it's something like 40%. If you didn't know that and you needed to get the answer quickly, Livermore Lab has the chart that will allow you to break that out at its first level of analysis, which is not too often that important. So here's a takeaway that we get from this very much. What about worldwide global carbon flow? So again, a lot of detail, but again, looking at the fat paths, almost as much carbon emissions come from agriculture and forestry as come from fossil. So if you're interested in worldwide carbon emissions and you're interested in sort of a really high-level strategic approach to mitigation, then this shows us that it's not all about fossil fuel. And as it goes out, of course, we see a lot of geographic resolution, heterogeneity, I should say, and where there are fossil fuel heavy emissions and where there are biomass heavy emissions. But this gives us a high level look. Okay, so that's it for my quick touch on high level stuff, very high level compilations. And now I want to talk a little bit about comparing different technology alternatives that offer the same energy service. And we'll look at two tools in the toolkit, and the first is net energy analysis. This has been a focus of GSEP's for the last several years. And first, I want to give you a visual orientation, so I'll look at a concrete example to try to get a visceral sense of what the energy analysis is all about. And then carry that forward to look at some technology. So let me share with you one way of thinking about an energy conversion process. And think about very broadly. This could be the entire oil industry. This could be charging my battery. This could be storing energy. But no matter what the process is, there's always going to be some feedstock energy coming in, right? If I'm pumping oil, there's cruising down, I'm pulling it out, and that's the feedstock energy. I'm charging my battery, there's current coming from the wall, that's the feedstock energy. And then there's some energy to the consumer broadly defined, some immediate next use. And so if you think about a battery, okay, so the ratio of these two obviously is the efficiency of the battery. There's also some external energy input in order to enable that resource, right? So an oil rig doesn't run itself, right? You have to service that with a home other things and fuel, right? Battery doesn't manufacture itself. That factory has an energy input as well as the material inputs, which also track upstream to energy requirements. And there's some energy consumed by the process. Sometimes it's useful to have this explicitly denoted in our analysis of a process. But let's make this concrete. So here's an example that we're all familiar with, right? Personal automobile. What's the process that this automobile carries out that's useful to us? It provides what?
Transportation.
Right. And if we needed to get more detailed, we could be very specific, right? It provides transportation at a time that I want it. This country, right? It's always available to me, and it has particular characteristics of power. I'm living with a mic, right? So I have high flexibility. But it requires an energy input. So we're all familiar with the energy input for the combustion engine is gasoline. Okay. How should we think about the external energy input?
Manufacturing.
So I'm going to narrow down our scenario, right? I'm going to my driveway, and I need to go get some fuel. But I know my car really does. So what's the energy input? Make that happen.
Fuel you need to drive to the filling station.
Right. You want to drive to the filling station. So we're going to hold that thought in mind. Remember, what is it we want to do in the car? We want to hold places. Often we want to go fast and have fun. We want to do more mundane things like my groceries, which are necessary for families to exist. Where is that? Where is that energy coming from? Right, to allow me to fly the fuel, as noted, it's coming from what's already available in that system. Right, English car is a system. It's putting out some energy, which all of which could be useful energy. But if I'm using some of my gas to drive to the gas station, I'm not using it to drive to the grocery store or Yosemite or wherever else I want to go. So we can describe this as energy that's diverted from economically productive uses. Broadly speaking, you think now about a larger system, right? Instead of just one car, just provide much more. We have a large ecosystem of technologies, organizations, people pursuing different objectives, and they require an aggregate energy. What the energy in different forms. And so we're familiar with these, right? It's typically fossil resources in our environment in the first world. And just as in the more specific example of the car, there's an energy input required to go get those cars. And so those are, again, things like oil field services, or transporting oil around the world, or running, you know, mine shafts or big diggers or open pit mines to get coal. So of all of the energy that's outputted from our society-wide, economy-wide energy services sector, not all of it goes to final demand. Some of it goes just to keep the energy extraction process going. So the question then that and I want to point out, if you want to do, ultimately you want to do fun things or cool things or interesting things, things that are not the equivalent of hunting and gathering, but things that we associate with a high quality of life, like going to a fun sports game and, you know, manufacturing football helmets, or being able to spend time at universities, doing things that don't, you know, don't allow me to feed myself in an immediate way, right? I'm not harvesting corn. This is, in a sense, higher education, a luxury of a society that has the energy surplus from an energy ecosystem to an electric. So the question that energy asks is, what are the direct and indirect energy inputs that are required to produce the inert energy? Because from our previous example, what we know is that if we could take a small slice of our energy services sector output and recycle that back into continuing energy extraction, first of all, we'll have a stable system, right? We can keep pumping gas. And secondly, we'll have energy left over to do things like build and keep building and teach courses and go for hikes and play sports games. But what starts to what would happen hypothetically if the proportion of energy that we needed to recycle continuously into extracting more energy grew larger and larger, right? What happens when the proportion available for end uses that are desirable to us shrinks? So that's the question. That's the setup. And the characteristic figure of merit for thinking about that is energy return on investment, EROI. And the idea here is that if I have I get a lot of energy out, put a little bit of energy in, then I'm doing pretty well, right? High EROI is good. And we can know right away that the energy vectors that power our society, fossil fuels, are particularly energy dense. And that means that for the past 150 years, we've been able to build economic, industrial, social infrastructure that benefits from very high EROI. So there is, here at Stanford, is one place where there's been some sort of very careful systematic analysis unpacking what those numbers look like, how we should do this systematically. And this might be an interesting analytical infrastructure to have if we think there might be energy transitions coming up and we have to choose among different technology options going forward. So Adam Grant, here at Stanford now, and McDale previously at GSEP, produced one such example. And so this was looking at a processing state which is oil refinery in the United States. So as we saw a couple slides ago, there's some feedstock energy input at the inside, and then there's some net refinery output at the outside. There are some external energy inputs here to run that refinery, and then there's some inefficiencies just in the pipeline. So what should we, what should we take away from this one when we look at this? Well, I think it's fair to say that this is one component of the total oil extraction and production process, right? We want to think about total ERI of extracting from the well on one end and delivering to the gas station on the other end. This is an important part of the process, but not the only one. So I'm going to jump to the punchline, which is to look at some ERI values that have happened for different fossil energy resources. So this is the plot from this analysis of oil and gas worldwide, and it estimated an ERI of 20. That is for every 1 unit of energy invested in running oil and gas extraction and production delivery, we get 20 units of energy out. That's pretty good, I'll take it. This analysis also has values for coal, for tar sands, oil shale, diesel, and biomass. This is a good place for me to note that there is variance in the assessments that are made. And so the first number you read is not necessarily the correct one. You'll see that there are error bars even just in this analysis, and we'll see in a moment an example of some more variance. One other interesting note for the top of this particular assessment is that by some data analyses, ROI values for specific classes or categories of hydrocarbon resources are declining. So this is for global oil and gas, an assessment. This is for Canadian oil and gas in the orange, and in the blue, Canadian oil, gas, and tar sands altogether. So I say this not to show you that the verdict is final and we're heading into the ground, but to show you that this is a discussion of interest in some quarters, and I think it's easy to see why would you? Because you want to have that ultimate energy output to final demand available for us to continue running in society that we're accustomed to. So I mentioned earlier that one motivation for this kind of system analysis might be technology transition. So let's turn the same analytical framework around now to look at PV generation. So again, you guys should all be experts at this by now. How should we look at this data set and think about different energy return ratios? So what do I determine by looking at the input and the output? What's that?
Inefficient.
The answer, the suggestion is inefficient. My suggestion is going to be we can determine in a value neutral way the efficiency of the process. And indeed, we see that for those who can't see, at the input side there are 100 units of energy, and at the output here there are about 16 units of energy. So indeed, 60% is pretty low, at least when we think about fossil conversion efficiencies that we're used to. But for anybody who works in photovoltaics, 15%. Okay. I mean, not long ago that was cutting edge, right? But that information is encoded and embedded here in this slide. Okay, so here is another set of numbers. And so what further information about this system do we obtain by looking at these numbers? These are the external energy inputs into the system, right? This is the oval at the top in blue, encircles all of the energy inputs that we had to do at factory to transport materials to build the solar cells, to transport those cells, to install them. So these are the energy inputs from the rest of our industrial ecosystem in order to enable the capture of it. Okay, so this is the EROI. This is the energy return. Sorry, the ratio of these two is the ERI. If you read the paper, squinted, and added up these values, you would get to about 4 units of energy, okay, across all of the external energy inputs. So 16 by 4 gives you about an ERI of 4 for solar in this analysis. Again, I know that assessments will vary from one analysis to another. We'll see some examples of that. But here's one way to make very visually explicit and a very technically highly resolved way where the energy costs are in producing our energy. And you can also think of it as a hot spotting approach, right? And you see another analysis that takes that approach. If you're thinking I want my energy production to be more energy efficient, I would want to break down and say which stage and multi stage process is my energy. So here is a compilation of ROIs for renewable generation, also some some gas and coal. But just to give you a snapshot of one analysis. So I wouldn't take these of these absolute values in the gospel, but the trends are broadly similar from one analysis to the next. Gas and coal often aren't too far apart. Solar is often much lower. Wind is usually higher than solar. And hydro and nuclear, I have not followed the early discussion of those as much, so I can think of some reasons why the ROI might be higher. You'll see that this particular analysis was interested in determining the impact of firming renewables with storage on the ROI. They had their answer. I had some discussion coming from my GSAP analysis and a few slides. So here's part of that analysis. So McDale did a meta-analysis of the literature on the ROI of PV and wind. And these are his figures, ROI figures. So he found a PV, an ROI of around 10, roughly, and for wind, around 90, roughly. So again, the absolute value of wind almost saw a month ago, but the qualitative trend is similar. Wind is a higher ROI than PV when you count the manufacturing energy inputs. And again, you'll see here that there's a lot of scattering of energy analysis. So, so there are some ground-level takeaways here about the ROI of wind, and the never trust a single lesson. Okay, we'll leave that there. Everything that we've just been seeing the last few slides is a static analysis, taking a snapshot at one point in time. But making a PV cell, or many other technologies, can be very energy-intensive process, and in particular, for a technology like PV that doesn't require any operational energy input, the energy cost is front loaded. You're paying it all out at the beginning. Before you get any benefit from the PV cell, you're spending basically all the energy you're ever going to have to put into it, so to speak, to manufacture and so on. And if you want to have a rapidly growing industry, that energy spend might add up very quickly, might add up more quickly than the energy benefit that you're getting from your PV installation. So here's a dynamic net energy analysis of the PV industry, McDale's work here at GSAP. And the schematic is here, right? There's a lot of energy spend, so we'll count it as a debit against the industry, a lot of energy spend into the industry in order to get up and running for the production lines going. And more gradually than the energy spend, more gradually, the energy output from all those installations will gradually accumulate. And so if we're integrating over time both the debits and the credits, how does it balance out? Should we be concerned about whether the PV industry is sucking away energy from the rest of our ecosystem? The short answer to that is no, by the way, don't worry. And this just sketches out some of the ways that we quantify it, right? So at a certain point, the energy spend to continue building production lines is matched by the energy output from the facilities, okay, so that's a break even year. And then at a certain point, the cumulative quantities of energy investment and energy output, the curve will cross, right? And the industry will become cumulatively an energy producer as well as an instantaneous energy producer. So here's just some data showing, data up to 2011, showing that PV is rapidly growing, right? So rapidly growing industry, front-loaded energy costs, the question is relevant for PV. And here's a way for us to think about this graphically. Okay, so this is a space in which the green area indicates that you're in an energy surplus region, the red area indicates that you're in an energy deficit region. And what are some of the factors that determine where you are at any given point in time? One is, what is the growth rate of the industry? What is the energy subsidy that it's pulling from the rest of the economy? Another is, what's the capacity factor of the PV systems, right? The higher the capacity factor, the more energetically productive your energy investment is for you. And another is, what's the energetic cost of PV that you're building? The lower the cost per unit of generation capacity, the less emissions. The greater the cost per unit of generation capacity, the longer the payback period might be, the more demanding this question might be. So I'll show you this same space now with one specific technology plotted. This is CadTel, and this is a time course. So going back for not quite a decade, initially the industry, the CadTel industry, was in a positive net energy region. It started to ramp up, a lot of energy expenditure went in to expand production. But as that additional capacity came online, the growth rate was modest enough that it came back into net energy production territory. Now, why won't these traces all look the same for different technology? From a technical side, the reason is that they have different energy intensities to build one, you know, kilowatt of capacity. And also they have grown at different rates. So here are the courses for different technologies. Crystalline silicon represents the lion's share of installed capacity, and we can see that for most of the last decade, it's been pretty close to the break-even line, and at least as of 2012, multicrystalline silicon is starting to come back into net positive energy territory. So the takeaway from mixed study is that we are just about at break-even right now, and he anticipated that the cumulative investment would be paid off by cumulative PV production in the early 2020s. I forget the exact number, but that was the takeaway from that. It's a very thorough analysis, which points towards one of the real possible wings in that energy analysis, which is to think about the extent to which one sector of our energy infrastructure is subsidizing another sector of our energy infrastructure. When that happens, is that a good thing? Is that something that we're concerned about? Right. So we're in the red region here, and then other sectors of our energy infrastructure are subsidizing the PV industry. Once it comes back in positive territory, then no longer. The PV industry is now an energy producer. We can use the same analytical framework to think about energy storage, which is another energy service, which is becoming increasingly important for thinking about higher levels of renewables penetration. So just as we define energy return on investment as the ratio of the total energy output to the total energy input for a particular process or for an economy, so too with storage, right? Now we're going to think about the process of storage process. We're going to think about the total energy dispatched from a particular storage installation, when we get the power storage industry, and compare that to the embodied energy to manufacture and install that storage. And so, Barnhart, working at GSA, described this as the energy stored on invested. So, by analogy with EROI, we'll call it ESOI, ESOI. And why might this be interesting? Well, because there are a lot of different energy storage technologies out there in discussion. Okay, not a lot of deployment, but as you're all aware, there are a number of battery chemistries and other non-electric chemical technologies under development. And so it's an interesting point in time for EROI to install to ask questions about, which is broadly socially beneficial to us. So here is a summary of both Charlie's work and my work on hydrogen, thinking about hydrogen for storage. And it's just a bar plot of the ESOI values of a number of different technologies. On the left, in the brown, are geologic technologies. So this is compressed air energy storage coupled with natural gas for energy output, and pumped hydro storage, pumping the water uphill and bringing it back down when you want the energy out. So these are very high energy stored on invested ratios. So here we have, then in the blue, are various batteries. Lithium-ion battery on the left, sodium-sulfur, vanadium redox batteries, zinc-bromine batteries, and lead-acid batteries. And we can see that, first of all, they're all a lot lower than the geologic storage. And second of all, they are not all equal in terms of thinking about the energy. And then I did some additional analysis thinking about what hydrogen would look like if you use, if you had grid electricity, if you have open generation coming from a wind farm or a solar farm, right? Either the instantaneous grid capacity or the demand on the grid, you want to store it. That's kind of the use case that we're thinking about for all of these technologies. And so if you want to do that in hydrogen, you would put the energy, put the electricity into an electrolyzer, generate, capture, or store the hydrogen, and keep it there until you were able to put it through a fuel cell to recapture the electric power. Other interesting reasons to think about hydrogen, but we were thinking about it just in terms of a grid storage source. So in terms of the energy input to manufacture the hardware that you would need to do that, that looks favorable compared to batteries. Now, some of you may already know that the relative efficiency of the process that I just described, hydrogen, is quite low, lower, I think, than any of the batteries here. So here you have an interesting situation where one energy return metric seems to favor some particular technology, and a different energy return metric seems to favor a different technology. So this is a good place for me to point out that I wouldn't want anybody to go away from this room thinking, as a result of my talk, that these are tools that we should use to choose one rather than the other. These are information inputs, to put together on a panel of available information. And the way any decision maker will weigh one data point against another will depend on the particular circumstances and challenges to address. Back to this. So thinking more quantitatively about this particular use case of capturing over generation. If I don't have any storage and my wind farm is generating too much power, then I'm dumping, I'm curtailing. So this has been happening at least up until very recently. In Texas was often a textbook case. And the higher the penetration of these intermittent renewables, the more of an issue this becomes. Because you're going to spend money and energy to build a generating resource and watch it become energy. So alternatively, we build a storage resource that captures it over generation and then provided at a later point in time, that has the benefit of capturing all the generation, but it has the downside of incurring additional energy costs to the battery. So how do we think about those two? Here is a space in which I'm looking at the aggregate EROI of a storage-enabled mini-grid. So not just the generation itself, not just the high EROI wind power, let's say, but the taking into account the energy cost to build the wind turbines and the battery, and total energy output from the wind turbines directly to the grid and to the battery. And use that to determine a system-wide EROI. And that is plotted here against the proportion of total generation which is diverted through the battery. So maybe 25% of my wind farm output over the course of the year would otherwise be curtailed. Maybe it's only 10%, maybe 60%. I hope not. That doesn't sound like a good business case. But the when I plot these grid ROIs in this space, they look different for different technologies, because different technologies and storage technologies have different ESOI ratios. And the ROI of the generating resource and the ESOI of the storage resource and the efficiency of the battery and the proportional diversion all interact together to produce these different curves. And one of the takeaways is that although hydrogen has a pretty low relative efficiency, it has a high ESOI, as we noted earlier, and that in this storage-enabled grid context, it looks just as good as any of the battery technologies on an EROI basis. So again, this is thinking not about return to my financial investors, this is thinking about husbanding our society's energy resources, right? What do we get in terms of running our society in exchange for our industry's investment in building wind farm or other energy? So these two lines up here are pumped hydro and compressed air, which is a very high ESOI ratio. But if you're now choosing between, if you're in a place where those are not geographically available, right? You don't always have subsurface caverns or tall mountains nearby waiting for the reservoir. So if you're in a place where you don't have those things, but you can build a concrete pad and put something on it, what are you going to put there? Is it going to be radium redox or lithium ion or hydrogen? Many people look at hydrogen and say, low efficiency is not good for us. And they might be right, but it might also be useful to know, especially if you're a public agency, right? It's not necessarily profit driven. To know that on an energy basis, that's not the story. There's more that we get in this kind of analysis. And the final thing to note is that, as we saw on the earlier slide, the EROIs of fossil energy resources, like oil and gas, are somewhere around 20 or 30. So if I can build hydrogen vanadium redox battery, and couple it with wind, then I'm probably, somewhere around 25% diversion. But I'm still getting a better EROI in terms of society's total energy investment to produce that electricity than if I were using coal-fired or gas-fired power. So that's the takeaway. Storage technology with a low efficiency, but a high use story might still yield a benefit to us when thinking about society's overall energy resources. And this approach in that energy analysis and various configurations is what highlights that. So now let me shift gears and talk about another item in the toolkit called life cycle assessment, with which some of you may already be familiar. And it's either a close cousin of net energy analysis, or it's the umbrella discipline of net energy analysis. It's not entirely clear, but it proceeds from a similar intuition that you have to consider the entire life cycle of a product or of providing a service in order to think thoroughly and critically about how it compares to other options. So the first thing to say about LCA, the acronym for life cycle assessment, is that it encompasses, at least in principle, all stages of providing a service or building a product. So here's a graphic thinking about building a product, starting with materials extraction, right? How much iron ore did you extract to make the steel that went into your automobile or into the skid that you've mounted your fuels on? Manufacturing processes, many are not especially energy intensive, but some notably are. So steel making is one, refining other particular metals that might be electrochemical couples and batteries would be another. Silicon refining is very energy intensive. Distribution, transportation, of course. What's the use phase impact of my particular technology? If we're thinking about electricity generation, so a coal-fired power plant is going to have continuous inputs of an energy resource that is valuable to our society, right, in order to produce the output. A PV system is going to be different, right? So PV is going to have essentially no contribution to total impact from the use phase. Here I'm neglecting small contributions, such as washing off the panel. And then end of life management. And then the other thing to say about LCA is that it's a codified and standardized discipline and process. And so there is at least, in principle, a standard to aspire to reference to in terms of whether you've done a full LCA and what the best practices are. But LCAs are, though valuable, also imperfect. So as with energy analysis, LCA studies might have different system boundaries. Even similarly, scope studies might come out with different results, just legitimately, because they had different data sets to start with, and they spoke with different manufacturers. I've been spending more time in the LCA literature lately, and my takeaway is to be a critical consumer of this information, just as if you're reading newspaper or information online. The information is important, but still have to think about where it's coming from and how it's developed. So let's get concrete here again, thinking again about personal transportation. So we are all familiar with gasoline vehicles, and it's kind of exciting that might not be the baseline by the time my kids are of licensing age. We drive a Leaf now in our house. So how should we think about which is cleaner, which is overall beneficial for the environment, gasoline or electricity? Maybe some of you have considered this already. Any thoughts?
Typical literature says it depends on where your electricity comes from. Coal generated or more carbon free generation sources.
Okay, so it depends where the electricity comes from. Any other thoughts? Is that going to be the dominant impact? Maybe it is. Anybody have a contending approach?
It depends on manufacturing.
Depends on manufacturing.
Yeah.
You guys may you have successfully completed it before. Let's look at one particular study. Okay, so this is not a meta-analysis, but again, for illustrative purposes, to see what the literature looks like when we try to drill down on that in these questions. So here's a recent LCA in a very well-recognized peer-reviewed journal that's asking exactly this question, trying to parse out the impact of gasoline-powered versus electricity-powered transportation. Excuse me. So I know it's a bit cryptic. GWP is global warming potential, which is one of probably about 12 or 14 impact categories that were assessed in this study. We're only going to look at two, don't worry. But this is one that everybody is familiar with and can relate to. So here at the bottom, ICEV is internal combustion engine vehicle. So there are two scenarios that they analyze in which they're thinking about gasoline vehicles or diesel vehicles, ZRG. And then the top four rows are various electric vehicle scenarios. And they are distinguished by two factors. One is the particular battery chemistry involved. So they have iron phosphate batteries and nickel cobalt manganese batteries, two different widely explored chemistries for batteries, for lithium batteries. And also by the electricity source, as was previously suggested. And I think this is coal, natural gas, and the Europe-wide grid mix. And then, of course, the contribution to global warming potential is broken out by different phases of the life cycle, and in particular of the manufacturing. So they're breaking out the other powertrain as one category separate from battery. And we can see, so one quick takeaway is that in all of these cases, the fuel or electricity, the energy input to operate the vehicle, dominates the impact. And so that gets exactly to the gentleman's comment earlier that it depends where electricity comes from. But in a sense, it doesn't depend that much, right? It's all bad. Either you're burning gas and you have distributed CO2 emissions that everything else fights, or you're burning a fossil fuel to generate the electricity, and so you have somewhat lower emissions at a centralized location. Now, there are some reasons to think that a centralized location is better, because then you can do a lot more with carbon capture in a much more concentrated stream, and that kind of gets into this qualitative comparison among the cost and benefits of different technology options. But so, you know, one takeaway from this might be that battery electric vehicles have slightly lower emissions than internal combustion vehicles with non-coal electricity only, right? If you're burning coal to get your electricity, then you don't have a win in terms of emissions. So what about another impact category? Same study, same set of scenarios, thinking about human toxicity. And this is an interesting category I find to contemplate, because it's often one where consumers, that is not realized by the first world consumers of the products that we're thinking about. A lot of offshoring of manufacturing or international sourcing, and to the places where the resource that's needed is richer or labor costs are lower, and that often means offshoring various impacts, sometimes emissions impacts and sometimes human toxicity impacts. Metal extraction is one very good example. So how does that play out for these six scenarios, two combustion vehicle scenarios and four battery vehicle scenarios? So here the picture is quite different, right? So here it looks like the human toxicity impacts of the battery vehicles are much more severe. What are these two components of the bars? It's the battery and the other powertrain components. So I would anticipate that if you or I sat down to go through in detail these findings and go through the literature upstream, we would find the metals extracted into the battery bubbles is a significant component of this battery impact that's specific to the battery. But I leave that to you, and you need to do the homework. And then this study also finds that the fuel, the electricity generation for the battery sources has much higher human toxicity impacts. So that it was like they're saying that centralized fossil generation electricity has higher impacts than distributed gas and combustion. Interesting finding. So battery vehicles have much higher health impacts. So what is that? What's the simple answer using this data to think about battery versus combustion vehicles? Well, there's no simple answer. It's a panel of data. And depending on which criteria are most important to your locality or your national economy or your nation's transportation goals, you might take different conclusions from this panel of information. Oh, but batteries aren't the only next generation propulsion technology coming online for small passenger vehicles, right? You previously mentioned hydrogen. So let's add hydrogen into the mix. So what does that look like? Any guesses?
Battery's better.
And why? What caused you to anticipate that?
Loss of efficiency in the conversion process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I previously mentioned in the context of stationary energy conversion that the round trip efficiency of converting from electricity to hydrogen to electricity is very low, and that's pretty bad in the stationary electricity storage context compared to other battery couples. So this is just the same point now in the transportation context.
So I think it would be a similar answer. It depends on where your hydrogen comes from. It's a carbon-free fuel,
right?
But how did you get it?
Yeah.
Get it?
So So I love the idea that hydrogen is a carbon-free fuel, because it's just like looking at a Tesla or a Leaf that says zero emissions vehicle, or a golf cart, right? It says zero emissions vehicle. Well, yeah, it's true, it's a very strong system boundary. But you know, it could be a zero emissions vehicle, it's not going anywhere, it's not using any electricity. So yes, it's exactly the same point with respect to hydrogen, that if you follow the energy upstream, you can draw a suitably wide system boundary, it's not zero emissions. And so yeah, maybe you want to think about what the emissions are when you take an appropriately large system. So a different study tried to do exactly that. Again, one study. This is not my definitive meta-analysis. And so here I explicitly mentioned here that they're looking at kilograms of CO2 equivalent per vehicle kilometer. That's the impact category that we're looking at. What are the scenarios? We have combustion engine vehicles down here with different fuels. We have hybrid electric vehicles were included in this particular analysis. A battery vehicle scenario, and at the very top is the hydrogen scenario. And the key thing here, again, back into your comment, is the source of the hydrogen. So most hydrogen that's used today, that is not used as part of the integrated industrial process, as you may know, is from steam methane reforming. So SMR is steam methane reforming. That means we're getting our hydrogen from a fossil fuel. And that's pretty emissions intensive, actually. Hydrogen sounds great, and it could be great in certain contexts, because you can obtain it by electrolyzing water. So if you have clean electricity and you're splitting water, then you have a pretty low emissions overall. But today, that's not how we're getting our hydrogen. So what this is pointing out is that if we're going to build and deploy hydrogen vehicles in our existing energy infrastructure, our existing hydrogen supply infrastructure, then the impacts might not be what you think they are. Right? Really does depend on where you get the fuel from. So the takeaway here is that hydrogen-powered vehicles have higher emissions, if you're using steam and methane reforming. So if, again, in a scenario where we've got clean electricity to do clean hydrogen generation, that would be really exciting. Under our present economic conditions for different hydrogen generation options, a lot more complicated than that. Let me just check my time. Okay, we are on. So I'll just make a quick remark here that some people have pointed out that, or posited that there might be systems level benefits to a hydrogen infrastructure that extend beyond just the vehicle operation and the experience of the driver. And those would include things like having a storage system, which would be used to capture over generation or buffer intermittent generation, you might want to use that as a storage system, even for your electricity, because hydrogen storage has a much lower self-discharge rate than many batteries. Okay, that's cool. That's an attractive technical characteristic. And you can also use hydrogen as a combustion fuel. You could feed it into the natural gas grid. And that is now being done actively in Germany, especially, up to a certain relatively low percentage. I think it's around 5%. So maybe that's a useful characteristic to have. Maybe that allows you to reduce your natural gas combustion. Now, hydrogen, of course, is not going to produce any CO2 emissions when it burns. Maybe that's a good thing. So GSAP was fortunate to host a visiting student earlier this year, and Marcus, and he and I together worked out an analysis of this question using a highly detailed optimization model. And so if there's interest afterwards, I'm happy to come back to this, but I want to respect everyone's time. And just cut to the one of the takeaways, which is that if you have a choice between introducing battery electric vehicles into your community or fuel cell electric vehicles into your community, right, one which does not have any attendant hydrogen infrastructure, and one which would have hydrogen infrastructure. And if all of your hydrogen is going to come from solar-powered electrolysis, right, that's PVs providing electricity to generate hydrogen, then in this specific scenario, it's more cost-effective to reduce your community's overall emissions with battery vehicles than fuel cell vehicles. But as I said, this is a highly detailed scenario with a lot of inputs, right? And for a very specific scenario. And so, if you are a planner or a technical economic consultant, this might be the scenario that's relevant for you. Or the scenario that's relevant for you might be quite different from this. This is looking at one surface product community that does not exchange hydrogen with neighboring communities, right? And it is, we made an effort to integrate consensus forecasts about technology cost and fuel cost into our analysis. But, you know, there are error bars on that, and there are different scenarios of how it might play out under different future trends, cost trends. All right, so we've, now I want to turn to the last incarnation of energy systems analysis that we're thinking about at GTEP. And that is thinking about the impact of some specific technical advance and some specific technical application on a larger energy ecosystem of which that technology is a part or might become a part in the future. So I have a couple of examples about that. So one topic of broad interest, as you all have probably heard already today, is solar fuel. The idea that we would like to take energy from the sun, we would like to take carbon from some suitable source, right? Maybe biomass, maybe direct air capture, maybe a power plant, flue gas, and use some particular technological pathway to produce reduced hydrocarbon fuels, which are useful to us and which are in particular familiar to our existing energy infrastructure, right? A lot of which uses liquid hydrocarbon fuels. And of course, broadly speaking, this imitates what nature does, right? It does it at a much slower rate than what we would like to do. And so here on the bottom are first of all, visually makes the case about why we want to do this. If we really want to have a climate-stable, sustainable liquid fuels infrastructure, we need to do more or less what I just described, right? We have to be taking as much carbon out of the atmosphere as we are putting back in through combustion in some fashion. If we can take the carbon out of the atmosphere and put it into fuels that are then combusted, that's fine. We still close the loop. So that technology would allow us to get to the virtual cycle. Now we can think about doing with biomass, which sequesters for some period of time carbon from the air as organic plant matter grows. Or we can think about doing it in a non-biological fashion, which is my research background, which Donskoff was discussing earlier. So two quick projects of this kind. One is a prototype device to do solar hydrogen, which was developed by Lawrence Berkeley Lab as part of the DOE's Joint Center for Artificial Photosynthesis. They actually built a prototype I saw sitting on the desk, right, about this big, of putting in the right absorbers and the right catalyst layers and enclosing it in the right gas management. A fluid flow system that they can put in the sun and make hydrogen. So they've done this on like a 10 centimeter square scale. And the whole effort of that particular project is to prove this out as much as possible at small scale to see what would be necessary to do at large scale. But how good do your catalyst have to be if you want to get as much energy out in the hydrogen you produce as you put in to make the device in the first place? So this is, again, thinking about energy payback. It seems like a reasonable starting point to at least say that I want my EROI to be 1, right? Maybe I'm willing to subsidize the manufacturer of this kind of technology up to some point to get it running, but ultimately, if you want to have a steady state contribution of a technology like this to our energy infrastructure, it has to at least break even on energy. So how good does the catalyst have to be in order to get into that break even point? So this is the analysis that was from this particular study, same one as that, sorry for the overlay. And this is a variable stage that looks at two characteristics of the device. One is its operating lifetime, longevity in years. Is it going to operate for 10 years, 25 years? That would be awesome. How long does it have to operate if I wanted to break down on energy? Well, that's not the only factor. Another factor would be the efficiency with which it produces hydrogen from the sun. This is often called the solar to hydrogen efficiency, or STH efficiency. And so this is an analysis that varies those two characteristics, holding everything else constant, and find the contour line to the right of which you can break even on energy and to the left of which you want. So if bad practice, the axis doesn't go to zero, but that's all right. I know the authors and I like them. They go down to 5 years of operating lifetime here. So let's say the device is only going to last for 5 years. Maybe I imagine you know that. How efficient does it have to be? It has to be about 5% efficient. And if my device only lasts for 5 years and it's not 5% efficient, then it hasn't broken even on energy. Maybe it's only, I know it's only 3% efficient, but I've only started my lifetime testing. What number do I need to look for? I need to look for, it's like about 8 years of lifetime, just to break even on efficiency. If I can do better than the than that contra line, then I'm in that positive territory, and that's a good thing. That's what I just said. All right. Now, a moment ago, I was talking about liquid fuels, right? Hydrogen is not a liquid fuel. It may indeed turn out to be a very useful component of our future energy system, but we certainly know how to work with liquid fuel. So here's another vision more specifically oriented toward liquid fuels, and this is a project of mine that I have ongoing. So does this look like a good idea, or does this not look like a good idea? I mean, I think it sounds nice when I describe taking CO2 out of the air and chemically reducing it to provide us with a liquid fuel that is ultimately net zero emissions. Yes? No?
Yeah.
What more do you have to know in order to make a judgment, or are you already confident one way or the other?
I think it's a good idea.
Okay, we have one vote for yes.
Two.
Two for yes. Three, four. I hear four for yes. Yeah. Five for yes.
What's the energy required to make that fuel?
Okay, I have a request for more information. What's the energy required to make the fuel? All right, so waiting for more information. I saw two comments back here.
What does it cost?
What does it cost? Okay.
Cost per gallon equivalent.
Cost per gallon equivalent. All right, there's a businessman over here. Fair enough. No, nothing's going to happen without investment, so we need him on board. Any other thoughts?
How much energy does it take to take CO2 out of the atmosphere?
I like your question. Another request for information. What is the energy cost of capturing the CO2, which is the chemical feedstock for this process? So I only have one thought on this in order to be kind to all of us. But the slide shows the first cut of my analysis, which seeks to provide the information that was asked for. Okay, what is the cost of the CO2 capture? How much energy is required to carry out this? And so by way of James's, on the way to James's question of the dollar cost per gallon of gasoline equivalent, I will suggest that a good starting point is to ask what is the energy input that we need to get some well-defined quantity of fuel output. And that is the right framework, right? And we then can do the type of economics on the particular system that we're hypothesizing. So let me give you a quick tour of this. What am I applying? First of all, we already have methanol today. This is not a process to invent methanol, okay? We already have a way to get methanol. And we already have a way to get electricity without capturing carbon. So my future scenario is a scenario in which we have coal-fired electricity we capture from the power plant flue to get a sufficiently pure CO2 feedstock stream and put that into a reactor, give it low carbon electricity in the presence of protons, and get our product out the other side. So is that a good idea or not? My first counter question is, how does it compare to what we're doing already? Okay, so I'm going to suggest that before we decide, yes, it's a good idea, we should find out what the carbon emissions of this process, right? Part of the point is to pull carbon out of the air, at least at the same rate we're putting it into the air. If there are upstream emissions in any direction, which far outweighs the benefit that I would get by substituting zero carbon methanol for carbon intensive methanol, then all the rest it doesn't matter, right? Then it's not a win. Okay, so my question for us all is, what are the requirements, in particular on the catalyst, the electrochemical catalyst, to at least break even on carbon? So that's what this plot parses out. First, the yellow contour on each of these are the yellow band. And that yellow band is the breaking point. And you might guess green is good, red is bad. Right? So this shows me some regions in the technology variable space where I have to be if I want to be doing okay on emissions. I want to at least be beating the incumbent process emissions intensity. And let me, by the way, note that I strive to use a consistent comparison, right? So I'm comparing on the one hand the electricity and the methanol in the advanced case, on the other hand the emissions from the electricity that's coal-fired with no capture, and the methanol, which we produce today mostly in a natural gas-based process. So So I'm trying to do apples to apples here. I want you to know that. What are the four variables that I'm looking at? I'm looking at the electron efficiency with which the electrocatalyst uses my process electricity to reduce my CO2 to methanol. I'm looking at the atom yield, the efficiency with which my reactor takes every atom of carbon that comes in and turns it around to methanol. It might not be very efficient doing that. It might be a lot of CO, acid. I'm looking at the cathode catalyst over potential. This is a measure of the thermodynamic efficiency of the catalyst. No electrocatalyst is perfectly thermodynamically efficient. There's always some heat loss. So even though the reversal potential is, minus 500 or something, the operating potential that might be 700 or 800 millivolts, right? That delta is the over potential. And I'm looking at the energy intensity of CO2 capture, right to the point earlier. So I've included three different scenarios for that. Did I put the box on this slide? Yeah, okay. So one thing to say is that the break-even line is at relatively low values of electron efficiency and atom efficiency. So when I talk to electrochemists working here on campus on CO2 reduction, and I say, oh, 10 or 20%, nobody says, oh my God, we're never gonna get there. I say, okay, that seems like something that research might be able to do. Okay, research is a future unknown, nobody really knows. But you know, I think that this kind of analysis should be useful to us in thinking critically about which research program to pursue. Do we have a chance of success or not? That's one piece of information. Another piece of information is just where we are now. I'm still looking for information on the atom efficiency of catalysts that do this particular reaction, but the Faraday efficiencies are widely reported. And they're often in the 10 to 30% range for optimized bench scale electrons. Strictly research stage right now. But part of my objective is to provide some analytical framework with which to think about, again, which R&D pathways, which technology pathways we should be pursuing to the extent that we can at an early stage of development. Okay, I'll hold it there and let you guys bring back any questions. So that's my tour through different domains of energy systems. A quick wrap. Okay, what was our toolkit? Statistical compilations give us kind of a 50,000 foot view on what's going on with energy flows, and it might be useful to us in thinking about where a particular technology that I'm interested in or a particular policy that I'm interested in fits into the national or global scale of energy flows or carbon flows. We talked about net energy analysis, thinking about what is the proportion of total energy in that I can return, not just to continue to extract an energy resource, but to do things that we want to do. And we talk about life cycle assessment, which is can be a pretty powerful tool. We saw some specific examples of that. But again, we want to be critical consumers of the information in either life cycle studies or net energy studies. And some of the specific insights that we came across, worldwide fossil fuels contribute slightly more emissions than the biomass. This is a very high level insight, right? It's not going to tell you anything about what the state of California should do or the nation worldwide should do, but just good background information. Okay, we saw that wind power has a higher ROI than PV. That's a qualitative and consensus trend, although different analysts might have an absolute value for those two ROI values. We saw that battery vehicles, at least according to studies that we examined, have a slightly lower life cycle emissions than gasoline when they're using non-coal electricity. But the fuel cells, as exciting as technology is, probably have no emissions advantage over gasoline unless they're using renewable hydrogen, right? Depends on how it comes from. Suggestions they are exactly correct. And then we saw a couple of examples of trying to connect specific technical characteristics of specific technical systems to a larger energy dynamics. Okay, so in the case of solar hydrogen, we saw that at 5% efficiency, 10 years is incorrect, it should be 5 years. You need to have 5-year lifetime in order to get your payback. So that's me. We have time for questions now, and please feel free to be in touch with me at any point. So I'll hand it here first.
So when you did your EROI analysis, if you look at something like tar sands, you put a certain amount of energy in to get a gallon of fuel out. You burn it, and then it's gone. But if you look at something like a PV system, you create that PV system, then you put it in the field, and that PV system is generating energy each year.
Right.
So when you calculate the EROI for PV, you include the lifetime energy output?
Yes. So the, and this is what should be done for any analysis, either EROI or life cycle more broadly, for a generating technology that that has no continuous impact. There is, as we remarked earlier, there's an upfront impact and an upfront energy spend.
Yeah.
In the case of silicon, that could be quite large because of the thermal dynamic requirements for refining. And so, yes, so the energy spend is amortized over the generating lifetime of the device itself.
Okay, so, and you discount that at some factor?
That's a question that's been around in that energy discussion for quite some time. Should we practice energy discounting in the way that we practice currency or financial discounting? And so, I believe that Nick did not. I would have to double check to be absolutely sure. And in general, we do not.
Okay, but PV comes out at 4 then, even if you look at the lifetime energy production of that panel. Okay, and then just one related question.
Let me just add that I want to note that I know of at least one PV manufacturer that will disagree with that value and will note probably correctly that EROI values in PV have been increasing in recent years.
Okay, so why was the hydrogen efficiency not included in the EROI? Because it would seem to me that it should be included, and that would knock hydrogen down, but if I understood you correctly, you said it wasn't included.
So let me first note, and maybe it's already clear for you, that those two technologies provide two different energy services. If I understand your question correctly, I think you're asking about a hydrogen storage scenario?
Storing
good energy in hydrogen. So the question there is what is the energy spend to build the device, and how much energy will I get out of it? And in that case, I assume the particular use case of the wind farm, particular size, operating in a particular duty cycle. The short answer is to your question, I believe, is that the energy spend in the hydrogen case for every unit of electrical output is relatively low compared to batteries, because in the battery cases, you're doing a lot of refining of semi-specialty metals in order to build a battery. In hydrogen, you're not. You have to build the electrolyzer in the fuel cell, and those are power components, not energy components. If we want to store a lot of energy, just put a big steel can and put the hydrogen, which is, relatively speaking, energetically inexpensive, modestly expensive, compared to batteries.
Well, why is it not getting hit by the lousy ground trip efficiency? Because your ground trip efficiency is like 25%.
Because it has a long lifetime, partly, because it continues to function for a long lifetime. But the energy component does, just a steel can. Now, I assumed in my analysis that you will be replacing the PEM fuel cell from time to time, because the lifetime of the PEM fuel cell is shorter than the lifetime of the steel type of storage system. If you were denominating by power in and power out, it might look different, because then you're looking at them perhaps the more energy intensive component of the system that I described. But if you look at the energy storage component, that's a steel can as compared to a lithium system with specialty paste and separators.
Okay.
That helps. Okay. Yes.
Two questions. You talked about wind having to reject some of the energy that it makes. I assume for your analysis, you assume that wind doesn't do that, so it has a ideal capacity factor. Same with PV, and same for natural gas. Like a lot of natural gas turbines have been spinning down to accommodate, more PV and wind, on the grid. So what were the capacity factors you assumed for PV, wind, natural gas? In your return on energy.
Yeah. All right. So I cannot speak to fossil fuels because I was not involved in hands-on developing the studies for the fossil fuels. There are certainly studies out there, and I can definitely help you go back. In terms of mixed analysis of PV, he assumed, I believe it was something in the range of 15 to 20% capacity. Okay, in his analysis, that was the dynamic energy analysis for PV industries. He was looking at some worldwide statistics, and I have some of that data in my backup if you're interested.
Okay, yeah.
And in terms of the wind, I think I use a pretty optimistic capacity factor for wind, something like 25%.
Okay. And for each source, you assume that the grid could take whatever's made within its, you know, capacity factor. It doesn't have to, you know, periodically shut down due to, you know, changes in load.
I did not integrate that resolution of grid operating dynamics. In the study that I was looking at with the curtailment analysis, my assumption was that we want to capture all of the wind generation, right? I constrained the system to capture everything, and if the grid wasn't going to take it, then we'll capture it.
Right.
And so that then determined the capacity of the storage system.
Right. I understand.
I think I assumed that I wanted to have 3 days of buffering.
And then just to challenge maybe one of your final assumptions, you compared the battery electric vehicle to the fuel cell vehicle. I just encourage you to do an analysis of the fuel cell with carbon capture on steam methane reforming.
I'd love
and
to see,
if that,
see that
changes
yeah.
the conclusion any, because at least if you believe that one paper you showed, you know, the vehicle footprint was higher for the battery electric vehicle than the fuel cell vehicle. So.
Yeah.
The thing that was tipping the scale, so to speak, was the emissions associated with the fuel production.
Right.
And there's a way to perhaps address that. And carbon capture from hydrogen production can be a little bit less daunting than from some other sources.
Yeah, so I'm glad that you raised that. And for any comparative study like this, of course, one has to choose scenarios.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, of course, if somebody else is studying, not mine, but I read it with interest. I appreciate that. In any study like this, one has to
define it. Yeah, just because it makes your final conclusion slide.
Yeah.
Okay.
Fair enough. And yeah, I should add in the absence of CCS.
Yeah.
that's a great point. And I would love to learn actually more about capture from hydrogen production. Okay. Yes.
Yeah. Have you looked at oil from shale?
I have not, but others have.
What is the story?
So Adam Grant here at Stanford is more of an expert than I, and I'm not going to speak in his stead really, other than to say, I think I can say generally with confidence that, I'm not sure. Fossil is outside my domain. Okay, so tar sands come in at a lower ROI than conventional gas and coal. And boy, it's not going to take you long to find studies and literature on the energy returns of shale gas or the life cycle impact, because it's been so topical lately. And we can do a search right here after we finish up if you want. I'm happy to do it with you. I happen not to survey that for this talk. Yeah.
Should CNG, LNG, and liquid hydrogen for ICBs be included in the sample analysis?
Should CNG, LNG,
and liquid hydrogen?
And liquid hydrogen.
There's activities, search activities going on in all of those.
Well, I'll give you my own personal thing. Just Matt Pello speaking, not GSEP speaking, and not the short version of, you know, my perspective speaking on what research we should be doing. Just my impressions now are that, as I noted, I think, a few minutes ago, with centralized combustion, you at least have a fighting chance. You give carbon capture a fighting chance, right? So the CO2 concentration in the power plant flue is something like 15%, as compared to atmospheric, it's 60%. So if you think that part of the sustainability technologies portfolio should be capture and sequestration or capture and recycling, then you may as well bias things in favor of that and try to shift emissions into concentrated point sources. Okay, so how does that relate to transportation? So if you, no matter what your hydrocarbon fuel is for transportation, is going to be distributed, right? It's much harder to capture. So I find the way in the direction of thinking more about concentrated point sources of CO2 for as long as we have to have CO2 emissions. And I think my view from others, a lot of people see a highly electrified future for light-duty vehicles, and I know many people see a CNG future for heavy-duty trucking, marine aviation, something else, military, something else, right? Those aren't mentioned. But when I think about these things, that's how I think about it. Does that make sense?
We're going to have liquid hydrogen.
Liquid hydrogen, so here's what I know so far, is that you take a big hit on compression to liquefy, and I think also on evaporation. So I don't know. I mean, look, the automakers have come out with high-pressure gaseous storage so far in their initial toy they have, in the initial production vehicle. I know it's a very active research area, and I would enter that discussion with a strong cautionary attitude toward the energy cost of the phase conversion. Mm-hmm. I have no final answer, but that's the question I'd be asking.
But RPD has really significant research.
Yeah, look, I'm not a thermodynamicist, I'm not a fluids person, and people much smarter than I, thinking about the fundamental science of those conversions, and future research is unknowable, so I would expect the board, I'll just be very clear on what some of the challenges are.
If the last year or so, I've been seeing popular media reports, which are new to me, that there are a lot greater emissions from natural gas drilling and extraction and transportation that had previously been believed to exist to such an extent that some people are saying that natural gas is a dirtier fuel in terms of greenhouse gas potential than coal burning. I assume that academics have been doing this for years before the popular press picked it up. Is that already baked into your analysis of the energy intensity and greenhouse gas emissions of natural gas, or is that something that needs more research to be fully understood?
Two quick notes, by the way, the intro. My understanding is that the recent discussions about exactly this issue have been stimulated largely by recently published research on this issue. And there are two people I know at Stanford who have been doing work and others elsewhere. And so I think that some of the fundamental underlying analysis, the sort of discussion, is actually quite recent. And so is that consideration baked into numbers that I have shown? The short answer I think is no. So I'm not my focus area is not so much fossil. I'm very interested in how renewables compare to fossil on the various metrics. I get my information from credible sources, I hope, such as I've shown to you today. But the bar plots that I showed, at least one of them was from 2014, forget about the other, 2013 was the other one. So those predate the last few months of discussion about fugitive emissions. And they certainly will impact the global warming potential. How they will impact the energy return on investment is a different question. It gets into an accounting question, whether you are counting the methane as a source that does escape as part of the initial feedstock, which in the regional lab you would, and so maybe it will alter the ROI values. My guess, standing on one foot, as it were, is that the fugitive emissions are very significant, while we believe they are very significant for global warming, my guess is that they're relatively insignificant as a proportion of total energy, total methane extracted from the ground, and which means that the ROI wouldn't change much for a methane impact. But again, this just highlights that there's, we need to have our thinking caps on when comparing different characteristics of the same energy system, right? So we might not care about the impact on your life, but boy, maybe we should care about the global warming impact of the emissions. In terms of transportation, I don't think there was much methane involved in the scenarios that I showed. Although, as we noted, the hydrogen, the one case for hydrogen production was from steam methane reforming, so yes, if you want to be really thorough, you could have a look at the methane production and delivery upstream from the hydrogen production. Very good question. I wonder if it would double the length of that bar. I don't know.
Well, the same issue would be true with the use of hydrogen, because hydrogen is very, it's very difficult to keep hydrogen in in storage.
I've read the radio on self discharge.
In income?
Yeah.
Am I correct?
I read this very low stuff this chart, and I have to go find those papers. I think the answer may be multiple answers depending on.
I have a question.
Can I throw my hand here? I saw a person that come back.
Under an ideal scenario with electric vehicle, i.e. completely charged from solar, are we finally getting to a point where the carbon intensity or the global warming impact is now substantially reduced, i.e. one example, the batteries probably need replaced around year 10. The amount of solar that you're going to have to make, the carbon footprint of installing that solar, and you can recover that in the 10 years that you then need to run and replace the batteries. Have you looked at it in that sort of scenario as opposed to just gas or coal or the EU?
I have not. I can't right now think of a report that I've read that has tried to deconvolute at that level of detail, which is exactly the right way to be thinking about it, I would say. So I think your question is, what if you take into account the full life cycle of the vehicle, including things like battery pack replacements, is it preferable to have solar electric battery electric vehicles in terms of emissions than it is to have our existing gas engines?
But with the fuel source that is as low carbon as you can get from the fuel source, i.e. all solar or
yeah.
solar wind.
Yeah, so here's how I would think about it. So let's assume that all of our feedstock electricity production is going to go to zero, approximately zero. I'll neglect the silicon refining for now, right, just to bias the playing field for the moment. In order to draw out that we still are going to have impacts from manufacturing, from embodied energy and embodied carbon. And so this is what you're getting at, I think, when you're pointing out the possibility of battery replacements. The energy, even if the electricity was truly, truly, truly carbon-free, the carbon footprint and energy spend would never decline to zero. It might get quite a lot lower, and I think it's fair for us to consider that to be a big win compared to where we are now. I think of myself as a pragmatist, not a perfectionist, right? So if we can install a ton of, utility CSP and use that to drive our leaves, yes, let's do it. At the same time that we're looking for, battery couples that have lower upstream emissions of environmental impacts. One other thing to keep track of, it would be nice if we got to the point that our energy infrastructure, but this was the main issue. There are different energy vectors of different qualities, right? If I have PV on my rooftop, I can use that to charge my car. That's good. But if I want to buy a car that's made partly of steel, maybe not very much because maybe at least they're going to be highly lightweight, that's good, and has a battery in it, right, which requires suitably refined electrochemical couples, those are high temperature processes. PV is not going to get me high temperature process heat. So one might say that the energy vector that I need for transportation, the most intense one that I require, is electricity, not high grade. Process heat, right? Okay, that's good. PV helps me there. But it's not going to help me to run my steel mine. And it's not going to help me to run my lithium mine. So there's a certain unsubstitutability that is baked into our energy system, and it doesn't bother us because we're used to it. But if we want to think about reconfiguring our energy infrastructure, that may become important at some point. And another example of this is what I alluded to earlier, right? So electricity might be great for electricity transportation, and we can pursue it. But for marine and aviation and military, they're going to continue to need high-density hydrocarbon fuels. So we electrify what we can, and we deal with the best under different, different needs scenarios. All that is helpful in some way.
Well, I've seen some of the papers on biofuels that show net removal of CO2 for the environment if you couple it with carbon capture. Can you talk to how that could play out on some of your analysis in terms of comparing biofuels with, advanced internal combustion engines versus battery electric vehicles and fuel cell vehicles?
Let me first note that my clock is 12:05 on our monitor in time. I think we're scheduled to end now. I'm very happy to keep talking with anybody who would like to stay. Thank you, and please be in touch at any time. And I'm happy to continue to chat. So thanks.